Well, welcome back to After Acts, but this time it's After Acts with Luke. And if you've been following along with us, we've done this is Gary, if you all know who Gary is, and then myself is Chris. This is our third series. The first time we just went through the book of Acts, then our second series was After Acts, is there life after Acts for Paul? In this series, we're taking a look at our next person, which is there life after Acts for Luke? And Gary, when we left Paul and we left Luke, something bad was happening to Paul. He was getting executed, which that usually ends a program pretty quick when you get beheaded. So let's just sort of look back to where we were with Paul and Luke in Rome, and basically the known universe of that time, the Roman Empire, was in pretty much mass disarray. So talk a little bit about, you know, how did we get here? How did this whole thing come about where we're truly in a world of chaos in the Roman Empire? So talk a little bit about that.
Just a little. Yeah. Nero is the emperor, and most everybody knows Nero was not a good emperor, not a good person, just from, you know, bare minimum history knowledge. And it's an understatement. And he actually gotten out of town for several months. And his assistant, things were so bad that the person he left in charge, Helios, sent messages to him telling, hey, you need to get back here. Things are falling apart. You need to get back here. But he was busy there confiscating property, executing people he didn't like, and participating in the Olympic Games and all the games and winning everything because nobody wanted to let him lose. He even won a chariot race that he fell off the chariot with and didn't finish, but they still gave him the first place, you know, a wreath. Nonetheless, Helios gets on the road and on a boat and grabs Nero and says, you need to come back with me now. And when Nero gets there, he's already got Paul in prison there, probably been through the first trial already there. And there's another hearing for the sentencing that will come. And in the meantime, there's people in the provinces around north of Rome, like in Spain, Gaul, that are fomenting rebellion. And so that, and Nero knows this. He knows things are falling apart. All his allies and the other people that would protect him are not going to protect him much anymore. So that's the kind of world we fall into. And he's taking more revenge. He'd already taken revenge on the Christians like 4 years before. And so he's doing awful things. And we're going to show a movie clip, actually, that brings us to that point. And the way we get here for us, if we want to talk about that real quick, is 2 Timothy chapter 4, where Paul says, I've run the race. He uses the terminology of the games, which is very ironic, but he knows what he's doing. I've run the race. I've, you know, finished. The prize awaits me, and the real judge will award that to me on that day and to all, but, you know, for being faithful. So he's ready to go, but he sends that letter. Luke is scribing it and sending it to Timothy and Mark and saying, hey, bring my stuff before it's all over. We could use that to write. We can use that. I can use your help. And we're going to talk more about that as we go after the days that Paul's gone. But just in the video, Paul is the old gray beard, bald guy, and Luke is the young, dark-haired, no gray guy with him. And then there's a couple in there, and that's Prissa and Aquila. And this movie places them in Rome at the time, and they're ready to escape. They're getting out of town, and that's no doubt what Luke's going to do, as we'll talk about some more after the video clip. But just to set it up and so you know who's in it and what's going on.
All right, well, let's watch this. Now, this clip comes from the movie Paul, the Apostle of Christ. I think I got the full name there right for the title. Right. So here we go. It's about the very end of the movie. And you'll understand why. And we will put a disclaimer on this. Beheadings will happen during this, or at least you will see it sort of happen, if that makes any sense. But this is a great clip. So here we go.
To Timothy, my dear son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. Remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, descended from David. Do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, or of me, his prisoner. Rather, join with me in suffering for the gospel by the power of God. He has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. This is my gospel, for which I am suffering even to the point of being chained like a criminal. But God's word is not chained. For I am already being poured out like a drink offering. The time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. Spirit. Thank you.
And the clip does end quickly, a little abruptly there, but
that's all right.
Boy, there's so much to unpack there. The one thing I wanted to sort of lay a little bit of groundwork is, man, just to put into perspective how crazy these few years are, because we find ourselves what in 68 AD. So 64 AD is when the Roman fires took place, which sort of started this. And if you follow the series before, we had Paul going to Spain at that point and Luke following along right with him. And then not only do you have Rome on fire, Nero being Nero, which was not a good thing, but we also have then in Jerusalem, the beginnings of a revolt that will end up with the destruction of the temple in 70 AD. So these are perilous times. You want to talk about COVID being crazy. This is crazy times in the Roman Empire at this point. So let's talk a little bit about the movie. You know what, and you can, if we do have an outline for this series that you'll be able to get. And one of the first things we talk about, we're watching this movie, which is these Christian movies are great from the aspect of they bring the scripture to life, but they're an interpretation by a creative mind, very much like what we're seeing with The Chosen. Great, very good, solid biblical teaching. But at the same time, they don't get everything right because they do take some creative license. So, I mean, what'd they get right? What'd they get wrong, Gary?
Well, before I mention that, I guess that's one thing they got right is the power of that, of being there at that moment. I'm emotionally moved no matter how many times I see that clip. So just to say, they did a fantastic job of putting that together to evoke the kind of emotions you should feel when somebody amazing like that has something like that happen. The one thing factually, Luke being present, remember in 2 Timothy 4, it says Luke alone is with me. The other guys had come, Timothy and John Mark were probably around, but probably not there at the execution as they weren't. You could only have two at the most slaves or assistants to be there with you. And Luke was the one that had been there all along. And the movie was about Luke. So they, you know, they kept consistent there. And then Paul's sympathy, there's a scene where he grasps the arm in the handshake with the Roman tribune that's there overseeing his execution. And that was powerful. You have to remember, Paul grew up in a family business, the tent making business, where they dealt with their number one customer, the Roman officer, all through his life. He knew how to talk to Roman officers. He knew they were people, and he, all through his experience, particularly with Julius, for instance, on the shipwreck in the Book of Acts in chapter 27, he knows Roman officers, and he knows Roman culture and life, and being a Roman citizen himself. That seems right on, and there's more to it before that. But to have that simpatico, that relationship, I thought they got right. And then that instant nature of death and beheading, that it was the most humane way to execute somebody in the day. Crucifixion, the least humane way. And that leads me to one of the things they got wrong was, and the only thing that I could think they really got wrong was they had it sort of as a private setting where there was just the executioners and Luke. And actually, Jesus's crucifixion at an entry of a main road into the city, it was the same thing here. This was at a gate, a city gate, or outside the city gate on one of the main highways to the main port for Rome, Ostia, to the southeast, the southwest. And it was the kind of thing where they wanted the highest traffic. They wanted people to see this execution, even though this one is humane. They wanted people to see it as a deterrent. You're going to tell yourself, I'm not going to have that happen to me. I'm not doing what he did to have that happen. And so it was very public. But that's the only kind of factual thing I found. You know, I didn't see anybody wearing a wristwatch or anything like that in the scene. There are people that look for those kind of things. They get wrong too. Now, one other thing they got right for me, and that was the life after death experience. Powerful scene. I think about, you know, when he's looking at the people that are there, he's seeing maybe family that he had, you know, that have gone before. Maybe he's seeing the people he led to their deaths. You know, he says in Acts and Galatians that his fury had led people to chains and their death. And so maybe he's seeing them and they're welcoming him as one of them now, because he too has lost his life for Jesus Christ. And and then Jesus shows up where he's coming to meet his Lord and Savior. And that's the common theme when people talk about near-death experiences, is getting to talk to Jesus and getting to meet him and seeing family members and people have gone before. So again, great scene.
Well, let me put something on the screen here. And that is, I'm as strange as it sounds, I'm going to put up Google Earth on the screen here. And I we were trying to find a map, to be honest with you, of the Ostia Way, and really didn't have a lot of luck. So one of the things I started doing was playing with Google Earth a little bit, and I've got the whole Roman Empire up here right now at that time. So are you seeing my mouse move?
I am seeing your arrow go places. Yes, sir.
Good, good. So you've got basically, you know, Jerusalem or Israel right in here. You've got Rome over here. And Spain over here, and where Paul was probably captured was down here in this peninsula right here, which is the Corinth area, and just generally speaking in that area. So one of the things we were trying to do is make sure that we give you sort of the lay of the land, and I'm going to try to pop in here to Rome. So let me see if I can double click here, and I'm going to bring you into the Roman area a little bit to sort of give you an idea of where we are. Now, let me put some labels on the map real quick, and then Gary, sort of let you, talk a little bit about this area. So Rome. And we put labels up there. Rome is up here. And then where we think Paul would have come out of Rome. And let me tighten it up here a little bit. Paul would have come out of Rome up here. And where would he have gone? So there we go. So Rome is up here, and he was in the Mamertine prison, and they would have taken him out, a gate to go into what? Austin Way? Why don't you talk a little bit about that? I'll put up an ancient map.
Yeah, just I just call it the Ostia Way.
Yeah.
There were actually two ports down at the end of the road, one on the north side, one on the south side. The north one was Portus, and that was a brand new one. That was kind of where everybody was now paying attention to. And Ostia was still important. And that's where the military mainly was based. But it was less important now for trade. It was more important you would go out of Ostia rather than through the big commercial port of Portus. So with the Tiber River, you can see that river kind of meandering its way through both the tight spot as well as the green there on the screen is the Tiber River. In traveling, and they would have been on the south side, or I guess it's more like at this point it's more like a east side, and coming out the gate to where on the road they would have done that kind of execution to make sure you saw it. Yeah, and so at this point, with bridges and things, there's probably a bridge yet to happen if you were walking and traveling from Portus or Ostia. And it's what, interestingly enough, this is one of the few maps we couldn't find and I haven't seen. So there'll be sort of a longer range hunt to see if anybody's ever uncovered all that.
Yeah, so the Mamertine prison where Paul was held was right in here. And then, you know, he's going to come out. We talk a little bit. You hear us talking about a gate. This is probably, you know, where he came out. That's the old Roman city, basically, right in that area. Mm-hmm. And then history or legend, however you want to say it, the Catholic Church basically shows two places where we could possibly have the martyrdom of Paul take place. The first, and if you see here, this is the this yellow line is the Via Ostia, the Ostian Way, and the first one is this Basilica to Saint Paul, right here, and then the second one is a little farther down, and it's the right in this area, which is the St. Paul Church of the Martyrdom. And just, you know, more because it's sort of fun to see make these places come alive. Let me take you back up to the Mamertine prison and take a look at what it would look like. And let me take this old map off. And I'm going to try to do something here. Hopefully it works.
This is basically what you get to see if you were going on a tour of Rome right now. Yeah. Go to these spots because you can and take tours there.
Let me get her back here. All right. So this is the Mamertine prison. And it's a real place. You can visit it today. And let me just put a street view out. Got a little close to it, but it's this building right here. And then if you'd sort of turn, you see basically the Roman ruins, the old Roman streets. These archways. So that's there today. It's real. Paul's a real guy in a real place. So if we go back out of here, and we're doing this on the fly, so sort of fun. But the church, the first church, which is this, let me get it here. This basilica right here. This place is pretty cool from the standpoint of you can see the church here and you see this little courtyard here. Well, in this little courtyard is a statue of Paul. That is Paul. That they basically have him there with his sword and the Bible. You've talked about this statue before, I think.
Yeah. Can you see it? Can you focus in to actually see that statue?
Let me see if
am I asking more than I should?
Well, you might be, but let's do this real quick here. There you go. Is that good?
There you go. That's dramatic, because that puts you right there, right underneath that statue, to see he's got the arm that's across the chest has a sword, which not only is the sword, some people might think that's what he's executed with, but it's actually the word. The word is the sword in the scripture he writes in the letter of the word of God. When he gives the whole armor of God. So, and he's got the word, or he's got a notebook, a Bible, maybe, but it would be more like a notebook, or, and which they used in Rome at the time. They weren't using it in the eastern part of the empire, but more in Rome, of where you would keep your notes and things. So, but yeah, fascinating.
Just because it's sort of fun to see it, is give you the view as if you were standing there, because it's a tremendous facility.
Monument, yeah.
Oh, yeah. And let's see here. So there's a view of it, and you can see that that background that was from the statue, from that statue of Paul, that would have been right behind these walls here. So it's a beautiful beautiful place. Now the get out of this street view here for a second, and the Catholic Church has one other place that they sort of claim as a potential place for Paul to have been executed. And it is just a little bit down the road.
Take us there.
What's that?
Let's mention, we don't know exactly where all this happened. And historians over time do supposals. They listen to the stories that were told by people, you know, as close to those times as possible, and the traditions that were there. And they, I find sometimes it's just good to see it all, see them both, see the multiples, just to catch a glimpse of the variety that is possible. And then you can choose yourself if you think one's a better spot than the other, a better story than the other. But there's supposals. Suppose if it happened here, this is what it would look like. And this is a, you know, connecting the dots to some of the stories.
So it's interesting, because both of these locations make perfect sense with the story of Scripture. Mm-hmm. You know, well, I shouldn't say for the story of Scripture, for the, you know, because
the story of those who wrote about the time after Scripture. Yeah.
Yeah. Because Paul's death and execution is not in Scripture. Not we there. Sort of know, especially with 2 Timothy, what was coming, you know, and who was there.
He says, my departure's near.
Yeah, but this is I will not try to say the Italian or Latin, but it's St. Paul's Church of the Martyrdom, and it's right along the route. You know, it's right along the route. So, you know, all of this is very, very possible, but it gives you this idea of what the lay of the land was, because part of what we're talking about in this lesson is, hey, if I'm Luke, which is who we are talking about, Paul has just been executed. And I thought the movie did a nice job of showing that people are getting out of town, you know, because, you know, their leader, Paul, where they were in Rome to support Paul, that support's no longer needed. And what's going to happen is we're going to try to save our lives at this point. So speculate, I guess, a little bit, you know, what's happening with Paul's followers, and in particularly Luke, what could have happened at this point?
Well, again, looking at Second and Luke, who's the scribe for that letter, send greetings, and they include three people who we can connect. That's Pudens, Claudia, his wife, and their son Linus. And when we publish the written part of this, you can go into more detail about it, or look at if you have access to William Barclay's commentary on 2 Timothy in chapter 4. The very last section gives you a great, it's the best supposal I've seen of putting use of all the historical material we have to show that there was a couple named Pudens and Linus who set a memorial plaque for a baby boy that didn't make it. Child that died in infancy, and it's on the Ostia Way. Now, why would you put a marker somewhere in memory of your child? And my best, my best look at that would be it's a place where you could see it often to be reminded, and where other people that knew him could see it could be reminded. And my supposal would be that Claudia and Pudens lived on the Ostian Way or somewhere right off it, in that space between Ostia and Rome. And since that was the new port at Portus, that area and those roads were even more kind of important going down. So anyway, I'm guessing Luke, when Luke was done at Mamertine with Paul, Luke probably didn't stay at the prison. There's no place to stay. There's no food there. There's nothing there, really. He would have to go back somewhere, and I'm guessing he might take the walk, a short walk out of town to Pudens and Claudia's place. And when Timothy and John Mark do join them, again, that's the scripture doesn't say it, but Paul's asking for them to come. And just imagining that that happened, supposing, okay, what if they made it in time and they were able to? And we're going to talk more about that later in a session. Where would they stay? Well, they could stay also with them. Now, the thing that really puts Pudens and Claudia in that place too, they're in the letter giving greetings. And Linus, their son, is evidently, if you connect the dots of all the historians, Linus is one of the next leaders of the church in Rome as a younger man. And so it's pretty amazing when you connect all the dots that are there to see those people in, you know, how they're using our house in hospitality. They're opening their home to these. If you think about who it's open to, Luke and John Mark, two of the Gospels, of the four Gospels written by these two guys, and the book of Acts, and the letters of Paul, and Timothy, and his place in writing some of the letters. It's just a fantastic story of hospitality in a troubled time. They're housing leaders of a movement that is under siege in many ways, though they're brave and they do it. So, go ahead.
I was going to say, the one thing that I think that, you know, we have talked about, but I think in past studies, but I think it's important to reiterate is there was a church already in Rome, and it, it is, yeah, I mean, and it's, you know, a decade plus old. You know, because Paul wrote his epistle to the Rome in, I think, 54 A.D. It's now 68 A.D. There's a whole bunch of things that have happened that have disrupted Rome, yeah. Small fire, you know, things like that. But there's a network of Christians, followers of Christ, that these folks that are coming in, Luke, Paul, you know, Mark, John Mark, Timothy, all that would have already known where to go So
absolutely.
So you know, so yeah, this isn't their first rodeo in Rome.
Just as an example of what you're saying, Chris. Right, because when Paul meets Priscilla and Aquila in Corinth, they had already been in Rome, Christians in Rome, and they left because there was the Emperor Claudius at the time had all Jews leave. And they were Jewish Christians, like the first Christians were. They hightailed it out for a while, and they were in Corinth. They were in Ephesus, kind of, following possibly the games or following seasonal market for tents and awnings and things like that. Then when what the movie is saying and many scholars feel is that when Claudius lifted that and there was different leadership there, there were Christians that went back. And so they had Priscilla and Aquila that went back in. And then they made decisions to stay during Nero's time just to support the Christian network again. And then remember when Paul and Luke and Aristarchus survived the shipwreck, get to the Roman peninsula from Caesarea and then Malta, there's Christians that meet them on the road and escort them on up. So that was before they were using, in that case, they used regium rather than ostia, or patchouli. But that was the kind of thing where there were Christians already there, and Paul was just connecting with them and telling them, my mission in the letter to the Romans, he says, my mission is for people that haven't heard it yet. You guys have heard it. You're strong church. I'm going to come visit you, but and he did get some great support from him on both occasions. So, and he was looking to Spain, actually. He was looking to use their support to get him further out to the West.
Yep. And so, I mean, you had a well-established Roman network of Christians. Yep.
Absolutely.
And obviously the persecution with Nero has reached a fever pitch. And with the martyrdom of both Peter and Paul, this is probably a wake-up call for some of them that we really probably should go somewhere, especially the non-Jewish Christians, because the Jewish Christians can't go to Jerusalem because there's a problem going on over on that side. So a Luke, who had the ability to travel within the Roman Empire, probably not the greatest place to stay in Rome at that point. So he's starting to hightail it out of there, and we'll talk a lot more about that. But let's focus in on these three people, this family unit, I guess you
absolutely
could call it.
And so they're heading down. I think from their place, wherever it is on that Ostia Road, Luke and Timothy and John Mark are getting ready to go. They're getting ready to be at the ports, on ships, and to head back out places. And I think that's like session 7 for us. So we'll go into more detail of where they head and where they go. But that's what's happening is with that road also being the road that leads to the main ways out. I think they use both ports. In fact, I think Luke goes to Ostia for the coaster, and he's going to go and go end up in Greece. Timothy's going to head back to Ephesus. And then John Mark could end up in Alexandria, Egypt. That's the largest Jewish population, even more than the Holy Land in many ways. And for so many people, that was one of the main places that people got out of Judea because of the Jewish war with Rome. By 68, Vespasian had uh, taken Galilee and Judea and a credit off, and then he backed off and just let Jerusalem and let the people in Jerusalem go after each other. The factions in the revolt did each other more damage at this point than Vespasian and the Roman troops, as they just kind of sat there and isolated Jerusalem. So it's no place to be either at this point. Nobody knows, because at this point Vespasian is just a general who was with Nero on the grand tour when Paul was arrested, and everybody would have expected that Vespasian was just Nero's guy, so that they wouldn't trust him. Later in his life, and for the life of his first son Titus, that would change. But for now, it's a scary world to be in.
So talk a little bit about these three people. I'm sorry, because they have some. You have some interesting ideas when it comes to where these, what the background is of Claudia, Putin, and all of these guys, because they're interesting, like you say, and they have some possible interesting connections for the church, you know, in general and in history. So talk a little bit about these guys, where you think they might have come from or gone to.
Absolutely. I didn't want to go too deep into it because I'm not sure. Huh?
Yeah, I know, but I'm gonna let you at least have a little bit of a rabbit trail.
Yeah. It's actually Claudia that has some royal blood, evidently, and it comes out of the Roman provinces and invasions of Britain, and her family being part of an important family in Britain. And so she's as a princess, she marries Pudens. Does that make him a prince? I think so. By marriage, at least. And often you think about Herod's family. I don't know if people know this. We're going to talk more about it later in the series again, because Herod's family members that are in the book of Acts are going to show back up in important ways in Luke's life. But they spent a lot of time. The Romans were smart about acculturating people and getting them assimilated into the Roman Empire. And the leaders that they left in, if they accepted the local leaders like Herod, their kids end up being in Rome and growing up in Rome. They were kind of like held at ransom, sort of, but they were also being given Roman education. They were becoming part of the Roman world. And so that when they went back to rule in their homelands, they knew what was going on in Rome, and the Romans knew them, and they were part of the Roman culture. So she's one of those people that lived in Rome and was part of a royal family. What happens then on down the road is we tried to identify the Claudia and the Pudens. There's two sets of Claudias and Pudens that show up again in other ways. One of them is in the poet Martial's poems or epigrams. They're short poems usually. And he published like 12 volumes over like about 14, 15 years. And Pudens shows up mostly as a friend of his, and then Claudia. And some people don't like that choice of the Pudens-Claudia couple because they're a little racy. But hey, in a racy anyway. And so that background doesn't bother me as much. But then the other couple that we know about is the couple that has the baby that they lose and make that plaque that is still that was found by archaeologists and that's still part of inscriptions. There's like 16,000 Roman inscriptions from all over the world that are in Latin that are cataloged. Not all of them are accessible in English. And that, I couldn't find the English translation of this one, and I couldn't find the photo of it either because they're still building that database online right now. But anyway, it is mentioned in lots of books about that. So they have a history as a couple. Again, making those supposals about where they were and then having Linus. They did have another child, and they have a child who grows up to be an adult and become an important part of the Christian church in Rome during a very troubled time.
Yes, I mean, there's always these stories. You get these people that are mentioned, and these guys are mentioned, I believe, just once in 2 Timothy chapter 4.
Just greetings.
Just greetings. But obviously they had...
Name dropping there.
Oh yeah, just a little bit of name dropping, but there's much more to the story. I mean, because hey, listen, we believe that the Holy Spirit inspired the writer, so the Holy Spirit Amen. Put it there for a reason. He had Paul put that in there for a reason, and you know that came from the pen probably of Luke, and mm-hmm. you know we find out that there, you know, one of them is going to be Linus is going to be what? Is he the first bishop of Rome or one of the first ones?
Well, they would call him the bishop to follow Peter. There's a line of succession that sometimes has Linus next once Peter and Paul are out of the picture. There's another person who's in there in the middle that there's a theory that explains why he's there until Linus is next. So, but yeah, he's one of those early people who's head of the church that they would, I think they go back and call him a bishop in our language now, but it was a overseer, a leader of the church that Paul uses that language in Timothy and Titus to describe the leaders of churches all over the globe.
Yeah, so we've got this group of people, you know, this family obviously staying in Rome, you know, because they're from there. If they are royalty of such, they have at least some clout to stay alive. But then we have the
That's
rest.
Right. They have means and they're protected in that way.
Yeah.
Right.
And then we have the rest of them that are you know, mentioned in 2 Timothy that we assume got there that are running out to the world. And you know, that's sort of the fun about what we're going to talk about in these next couple of, you know, weeks or sessions, however you want to call it, is really trying to figure out, you know, Luke is such an important figure in the New Testament. Now, maybe not as a character in the scripture, but the you know, at the very least, the gospel loop in Acts is a big part of what's going on. But then you see these epistles that are out there that he's involved with, that he is a eyewitness to. And then we'll talk later on about the book of Hebrews, which we believe he was the secretary of. Which means it's Paul's writing, but it's Luke bringing it all together, you know, probably right around the time of Paul's execution. So think about that.
Sure. Hey, Paul can't write in the dungeon, but he can tell Luke, here's what I want to talk about. Here's what I want to say. And then Luke, the way it would be as people imagine Paul being part of it or in any way of being part of Hebrews is that somebody with better rhetorical skills, better writing skills, formal writing skills of the day than Paul put Paul's thoughts into writing. And Luke is the one of the obvious candidates for that because he showed he could do that in Luke and Acts particularly. So it's a fascinating thing where he kind of gave Luke, here's what I want to say. You've got my notes because you got my notebooks that Timothy and Mark brought with them. Write it so that it's compelling in the way you can write, Luke, you know, and wow.
Well, and again, laying some breadcrumbs that we'll expound on later in 2 Timothy, Paul says, hey, go grab my books and my scrolls and my cloak because it's cold.
It's cold. Yeah. So Mamertine was a constant cold 55 degrees if my memory serves me right. So when the winter was coming, it was not going to be perfect.
So I mean, you think of the wealth of information, a precious material that Timothy picked up and brought to Paul, and now all of that, you know, from an assumption standpoint, it is purely an assumption standpoint, is now in the hands of Luke, and. Whoa. I mean, you have all of Paul's.
And Timothy and John Mark.
Yeah. I mean, so all of a sudden, all of that stuff that Paul used, you know that his copy of the Old Testament, probably the Septuagint is in there. You know that copies of his correspondence could be in there. So all of those epistles that we know of today, a copy of those originals are with probably Luke, could be with Timothy, could be with Paul, with John, who knows? But man, the wealth of Christian knowledge that's right there on these persons. I mean, it's amazing to think about.
Mm-hmm. And later sessions again. We'll suppose, along with other scholars, what could have happened with all that information, and how did it get to us today?
So I guess to set up a little bit of what's to come, unless there's any points that I didn't bring out that you wanted to bring out at this point.
We've got it. I'm good.
Okay. Just to sort of set the stage here, we hear from Christian standpoint, we hear about the things that are going on around. We hear these names of emperors. We hear these historians, Josephus, and things like that. We hear these big events like, I don't know, Mount Vesuvius blowing up, volcano there, earthquakes in this region, the Jewish wars going on. We hear about all these things, but see, these guys actually lived in all of these things. And as all of this stuff is going on that we hear about in history, but never connect the dots into the lives of really the authors of the New Testament, we're going to try to bring that all together. And we found some very interesting things about Luke. Now, some of them are just mentioned so slightly that, you know, it's easy to miss, but, you know, in the next session, we'll talk about who this guy Luke is. And, you know, obviously, he had this relationship with Paul because he followed around for the better part of a decade, at least, you know. And we're going to find out where this guy came from, this guy named Luke that we see the title of his name on the gospel, and we see him as the writer in Acts. But man, he's a real person that lived, you know, at 14, 18 years after Paul's death? Is that about right?
Yeah, 14. I might mention to say what you're saying in a different way is we started today in the middle.
Yes.
At Paul's death. Back to the past that leads up to this point, we're going to look at this point again in more depth as they leave Rome. And then we're going to the future after this particular execution and Paul going to heaven. And we head out toward the end of Luke's life and his legacy. So like we start at the midpoint, we're going to go back to the first half. The second half is the future. And we'll go back to the movie title in.
There you go. So there's sort of your first session, and it's really tying up with, all right, Luke and Paul's relationship earthly wise has now ended. Usually a beheading will take care of that, but there is so much more to the story. So in our next session, we're going to go back maybe about 30 years and try to figure out who this Luke guy is. And when I say 30 years, that's actually more than that. We're going to probably go into the 30 AD, around the time of Jesus, you know, maybe a little bit before his earthly ministry. And we're going to try to find out where Luke came from. So with that, unless I missed anything,
Let me amplify one more thing, just a thought to leave with. Is something you said or mentioned was Paul is the voice. He's the drama that the book of Acts, the second half of the book of Acts is about, though it's Jesus in the bigger picture. But Luke never really makes it about himself. He hints about himself being with the group here and there, but no matter what he's doing, there's a great humility here, and he's lifting somebody else up. He's support team for somebody else. He uses his gifts and talents for somebody else. And in the end, it's for Jesus, because he's just teaming with Paul with other people in the church to lift Jesus up. And I would encourage everybody to see Luke that way, as somebody who he probably wouldn't have even wanted the gospel to be called after his name, though that's the way it all ended up for people to decide and choose which ones they are, because he didn't mention himself or name himself in anything. It was Paul who named him and there may be one mention where he gives a tell right in the middle of the book of Acts, and we'll talk about that in the future. But otherwise, he's just in the background, and he's lifting Jesus up as he lifts up these workers and somebody like Paul, who had international influence and then historical influence that we're still in the big wave of even today. So to see our part to be able to lift people up like Luke in their work, because nobody's going to know about Gary Olsen much, except just people that, you know, a few people I've met in my life. But hopefully if there's another 100 years, 200 years, they're going to know about Luke, and they're going to know about Paul, and they're going to know about Jesus because of the work we're doing. So thanks, Chris.
Well, I'll end it by saying, before we go into prayer, by saying that the poster child for the spiritual gift helps is probably Luke from the scripture. Luke is Amen. One that Amen. Lifts others up in the background. And like you say, in the book of Acts, we know him as we. And that's about it. So that's a great thing. So with that, Gary, if you don't mind, why don't you close us out with prayer for this session?
All right. Well, Lord, sometimes we feel as if we don't have a part, or we're on the sidelines. But Lord, there's a bunch of people on the sidelines that make the game happen. And we just are thankful for whatever place you put us in and whatever you've put before us. And we just ask you to send your Holy Spirit to keep us alive and awake to the opportunities to make sure Jesus is lifted up in the name of Jesus, that every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord, because we praise him and honor him and give glory to him. So thank you for this opportunity to lift these people up and their story. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. And we will see you next time. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks, Chris. God bless.